Welcome to the InfoWars Nightly News. It is Friday, October 17th, 2014, and I'm Leanne McAdoo. Let's get right into the news tonight. Well, the most transparent administration ever has some explaining to do. Remember earlier this year when Obama said the chance that Ebola would become an issue here for America was very, very unlikely, that it would hit our shores? Well, a federal government-funded study found nearly a 25% chance of Ebola reaching the U.S. in September. Now, this analysis was circulated among federal government officials prior to its September 2nd publication date. But nevertheless, President Obama falsely said on September 16th that experts across our government agree that America's Ebola vulnerability was extremely low. Now, this is in addition to the CDC, who also repeatedly assured the American people that the Ebola risk was low, even after this alarming government study was completed and, of course, was shared with their agency as well. So here again, we are being consistently told there's nothing to worry about. Meanwhile, they know that there is something to worry about. That's why they've been gearing up with all the hazmat suits and the coffin liners. Now, here, in addition to Thomas Duncan, we have two other nurses, and there's a slew of other cases popping up around the country. Here, Ebola scare in Houston after a woman who returned from Nigeria found dead. A hazmat team was called out to an apartment complex in Houston, Texas last night after a woman who recently returned from a trip to Nigeria was found dead. This next article, breaking: Austin resident under quarantine after potential Ebola exposure. University of Texas student is being monitored for Ebola after he was on the same flight as the second nurse. And not even the Pentagon is safe. The Pentagon was partially shut down as a precaution after a tourist falls ill. A tourist who said she had recently visited Africa was found vomiting in the Pentagon parking lot Monday morning, prompting a partial shutdown of the building. And of course, it goes on and on. There are many other cases. My sister is a nurse here in Texas, and she reports that there are about 10 people being held in her hospital system that are just suspected of having Ebola. But of course, these cases aren't being shared with the American public. Now, the CDC is basically warning New York City to be prepared. Just be prepared. Now, they're not going to shut down any flights, of course, but they say New York City should be prepared for more cases of Ebola, as New York City is a main point of entry. Now, what would you do if you were the leader of the free world and you wanted to stop the crisis at the source? Well, you'd probably implement a travel ban, right? Well, not this president. He's just going to keep on letting it roll in and hoping that, you know, it doesn't infect untold thousands. And also, when everyone's calling for a new czar, a new Ebola czar to help with this public health crisis, you don't want to appoint someone who actually has a little experience in the medical or healthcare background. No, you want to appoint one of your cronies who is not only a longtime government bureaucrat, but also a longtime Democratic operative.
McClain, of course, first came to national prominence as the chief of staff for Vice President Al Gore. He headed Mr. Gore's effort in Florida during the recount. He's gone on to be a successful investment banker, and also he's very well regarded in the Obama White House for his stint both as Vice President Biden's chief of staff and also as the person who supervised the stimulus act, the distribution of funds.
So clearly it's not about appointing someone who has experience handling a public health crisis, but someone who has a long time of experience helping to make the Democrats look good and hoping that he can help this administration look good. Ted Cruz said, "We don't need another so-called czar. What we need is presidential leadership. It's a public health crisis, and the answer isn't another White House political operative. The answer is a commander-in-chief who stands up and leads, banning flights from Ebola-afflicted nations and acting decisively to secure our southern border." Now, that seems logical, but you know, that's not what we do here. Now, when an actual doctor criticizes the administration's response to Ebola, he gets attacked. Now, this is the Huffington Post. They ran an AP story attacking Senator Rand Paul under the headline, Rand Paul contradicts experts, says Ebola is incredibly contagious. And their story starts, U.S. Senator Rand Paul of Kentucky told a group of college students on Wednesday the deadly virus Ebola can spread from a person who has the disease to someone standing 3 feet away. And he said the White House should be honest about that. Well, his comments directly conflict with statements from world health authorities who have dealt with Ebola outbreaks since 1976. Now, these sentiments were repeated throughout the liberal media, and it's clearly untrue. They didn't actually do a little bit of fact-checking and research. They were just so quick to attack him for what he said. This is according to the CDC and their official definition of close contact. It's defined as being within approximately 3 feet of an Ebola patient or within the patient's room or their room of care, the area they were where they were taken care of for a prolonged period of time while not wearing recommended personal protective equipment or even just shaking hands with someone infected with the Ebola virus without wearing protective gear. So it seems like it's actually the CDC that's contradicting itself. Earlier this week, they said that you can't get Ebola from sitting next to someone on a bus or an airplane. You can only give Ebola. But here they're saying that close contact is defined as 3 feet and saying if it's a prolonged amount of time that they can give and receive Ebola. Now, Paul criticized the administration who has likened this disease to AIDS. They say, you know, we know how you get AIDS, we know how you get Ebola, but Paul says you're not gonna get AIDS at a cocktail party. No one's gonna cough on you and you're going to get AIDS. So of course, the liberal media was so eager to attack him, saying, oh, I don't know what kind of cocktail parties the senator is going to, and they didn't even do any fact-checking of their own. They just quickly wanted to turn this into a political thing. And this includes a snarky CBS reporter, Katie Conrad. She tweeted, not sure when Senator Paul became a doctor, but says the disease can be spread from 3 feet away. So clearly, not only did she not check with the CDC's official definition of close contact, but she's also not aware that Senator Dr. Rand Paul has been in the medical profession for more than 20 years. So you can see, obviously, that his comments were directly in line with what the CDC says on their website. They're the ones that are constantly contradicting themselves. And this is even according to a tweet that the CDC sent out earlier today. They sent out one of their first Ebola facts, and it says, coughing and sneezing could potentially spread Ebola. Very nice. And then their next Ebola fact is about how long the virus lives on surfaces, that it can live on surfaces for a few days if someone with Ebola touches a surface. So here they're constantly contradicting themselves, saying it's not an issue for ordinary folks, as the president likes to call it. Meanwhile, they're quarantining and monitoring anyone who just is sitting near someone on a plane after the CDC sends this nurse on her flight, says it's perfectly okay, even though she's got a low-grade fever and she's feeling sick. So this is just total contradiction. And Obama isn't going to consider closing the border, even though they say that it's absolutely vital to stop it at the source. But he will send the troops to Africa. And now soldiers who are preparing for deployment to West Africa are given just 4 hours of training. This is 4 hours of Ebola-related training. The training includes hands-on instruction on how to put on, remove, and decontaminate personal protective equipment. It's followed by a practical test to ensure that soldiers understand the procedures. So here are soldiers who have never had any kind of hazmat training whatsoever. They're being given just 4 hours of training. Meanwhile, you have hospital personnel who are contracting Ebola, who are supposedly trained in this area. So this is really insufficient. One USA Today report describes soldiers being told that Ebola basically causes your body to eat itself from the inside out. Reporters are saying that soldiers are telling them that they're scared. They're being told that Ebola is worse than what soldiers have encountered in Afghanistan. So here, you know, a soldier, they can see their enemy combatant, but not when the enemy is an Ebola virus. Now, one hazmat-trained hospital worker has called the process of undergoing FEMA-certified hazmat training for hospital settings, she says, it's mentally rigorous and it's physically exhausting. She goes into great detail about what is involved in removing and putting on a hazmat suit in order to make sure that you're not going to be catching any contagious diseases. It's very detailed. That's why you can see why some of these nurses were still caught this disease, even though they were wearing hazmat suits. So it's quite frightening to think that our troops are only being given 4 hours of training. And now these are our soldiers. Also, you know, he's sending out the 101st Airborne, which is the pride and joy of the Army. But he also wants to send the National Guard. Now he's going to be using his executive order once again to send the National Guard. He's preparing an executive order wanting to send National Guard active duty and reserve engineers and logistical specialists to Liberia to help build Ebola treatment centers there. Right now, the soldiers that are being sent, they are staying in hotels in Liberia, hopefully not coming in contact with anyone who has Ebola. The president, of course, was met with outrage. Oh, hell no, has been trending on social media. More than a few Americans think the Guard is the last group that should be involved. And instead of being at home, dealing with crises at home, they'll be abroad and possibly bringing a crisis back with them. And besides, isn't there something else the National Guard could be focusing on, like securing the border? Nah, that's not what he wants to concern himself with. Never mind the fact that the enterovirus has killed several people thus far. We're seeing a resurgence of a lot of contagious diseases making a comeback. Now a new photo has surfaced that's showing illegal immigrants there at a border patrol facility wearing masks and rubber gloves. And not really saying what that's all about, but they didn't give details, but they did say that the men did not have the deadly Ebola virus, but rather that they are working with the CDC to ramp up safety precautions at ports of entry when they identify a traveler with a possible communicable disease. So basically they're confirming that these men do have a communicable disease, and so they're giving them masks and gloves, and then, of course, will probably be shipped on into the interior of the country where they can continue passing on these communicable diseases to people here in America. So it's just more proof that we are in a country where our president isn't really doing what it takes to secure the health and safety of the American people. And people are saying, oh, you guys are just conspiracy theorists. Why would the president want to do that? Why would the country want to purposefully infect its citizens? Why would they want to do this? Well, this is not a new idea.
In every crisis, whether engineered, natural, or accidental, the Obama administration has exacerbated it as an opportunity for control and manipulation. The Ebola outbreak is no different. But there are many people, from the powerless to the political and corporate elites, from hippies to microbiologists like Eric Pianca, who want radical depopulation. Just look at this letter to the editor. Of course, it refers to James Lovelock's Gaia theory, a popular way to sell radical depopulation to the masses, to the very people against whom it will be used.
I see the Earth as more than just a mixture of living things and inanimate matter. I see it as a tightly coupled entity.
And the way it's presented to the masses, it anthropomorphizes the Earth as a living organism and presents humans not as the stewards of God's created Earth, but as a virus. And Lovelock himself conveniently plays into their global warming alarmism, talking about global warming being a fever that the planetary organism, the Earth, gets from the virus, the humans.
And I like to think of it as a kind of organism, and not just a lump of rock with life on it. Any organism can have periods of ill health, and it was pretty unfortunate of us to start worsening the fever that the planet was already in.
And of course, environmentalists quickly draw the obvious conclusion that if mankind's a virus, a cancer, it must be eradicated. And so Gaia has been used to put a pagan, New Age, happy face mask on the grim reaper of depopulation and sell it as both necessary and inevitable.
So what do you think is a viable figure that Gaia, that the planet, can sustain?
I would guess, living the way we do, not more than 1 billion, probably less.
Here you sit saying we are facing doom. We are facing the possibility of 5/6 of our human population being wiped out within a century.
The theme has been picked up and repeated in popular culture.
There is another organism on this planet that follows the same pattern. Do you know what it is? A virus. Human beings are a disease, a cancer of this planet. You are a plague, and we are the cure.
So how do we get rid of this human virus that threatens our beloved Earth Mother, Gaia? Or, as another scientist puts it, those upright mammalian weeds. As the Church of Euthanasia puts it in their Gaia Liberation Front proposal, solutions to get rid of the human virus, like nuclear war or sterilization, just aren't as effective as bioengineering. It has the advantage that it could be done with just one person who has the right technical expertise. And there are multitudes of people with the technical expertise and the philosophical bent to do this, as Alex Jones pointed out in the documentary Endgame, 7 years ago.
Prominent University of Texas biologist Dr. Eric Pianka, while receiving an award from the Texas Academy of Science, said that the worldwide AIDS pandemic was, quote, no good, it's too slow, and went on to laud the virtues of Ebola because it would kill 90% of the world population quickly. But most frightening was the fact that in a crowd of over 1,000 prominent scientists, local newspapers reported that 95% of those in attendance gave Pianka sustained standing ovations every time he extolled the virtues of mass-culling microbes and man's destruction.
For InfoWars Nightly News, I'm David Knight.
And in response to the lackadaisical attitude with which this current administration is dealing with this public health crisis, pretty much endangering the lives of everyone here in America, InfoWars is calling for a national strike across the U.S., and we'll also tell you how you can win some big bucks helping us fight tyranny.
DNA Force.
When cells become toxic, they die early and aging sets in.
DNA Force.
No one has put together a formula that focuses directly on brain health, nerve growth factors, and optimizing your cellular energy at the same time. Just one of the key compounds, BioPQQ, is backed by major clinical studies.
DNA Force.
We now have the synergistic solution. Secure your DNA Force today at InfoWarsLife.com or call toll-free 888-253-3139.
DNA Force.
The globalist social engineers are not just targeting us with propaganda. They are manipulating our genetics. We are being targeted at every level by estrogen mimickers that lower our testosterone and other hormones and natural compounds that the body needs. After consulting top doctors, nutritionists, pharmacists, and others, we have developed what I believe is the ultimate non-GMO organic super male vitality formula sourced from powerful organic herbs and then concentrated for maximum potency. Super Male Vitality was developed to activate your body's own natural processes instead of using synthetic chemicals. Super Male Vitality by InfoWars Life is so powerful that I only take half the recommended dose. For a limited time, we are offering 15% off Super Male Vitality at InfoWarsLife.com to introduce you to this powerful supplement. Visit InfoWarsLife.com today to secure your Super Male Vitality. InfoWarsLife.com.
Stopping this disease won't be easy, but we know how to do it.
Fighting Ebola, the president says a travel ban won't work. So why are so many countries doing it?
A national strike is the answer.
I'm wearing the same shirt I was when I was in the car with that family.
There is zero risk. I said it. There it is. I shouldn't say that. There's no risk.
If there were any risk, I would not expose myself or my family.
A national strike will force Obama and the federal government to secure the borders and stop West African flights.
A travel ban is less effective than the measures that we are currently instituting.
I have a question for you. Do you want to end up like West African countries that are in a stage of panic and total collapse, with the UN estimating that over 1 million people will end up getting Ebola by December? Or do you want to stop it? The default federal law CDC regulation position for the last 30 years on Ebola, smallpox, black plague, you name it, has been the same. If there's a major outbreak in a country, ban travel from that nation to your country during the pandemic in that nation, and beef up security on your borders. AP reported today that African nations bordering the five countries hit have had no Ebola cases because more than 2 months ago, they banned flights out of those countries once it reached pandemic levels, and they put border guards with machine guns on their borders to let no one come in. Zero cases, they stopped the spread. The default setting in this country was to do the same. Instead, our southern border is totally wide open. Anybody who comes across is basically instantly legalized. The state and local jails are opening up and releasing all the illegals who are felons, who've committed crimes, because the feds won't even take them. The southern border is collapsing. The northern border is wide open in many areas. And the flights out of Africa are still coming in. Now, it was bad enough that they brought a bunch of Ebola patients from Africa here to begin with. That had never been done before. Then they put them in low-level regular hospitals, not high-level military level four. But if that wasn't out of control enough, then they started letting people out of the Ebola countries fly here when 2 months ago, the UK, France, Arab countries, just like Africa, had banned people traveling by planes into their nations. And they set up serious screening on their borders because they didn't want Ebola. Spain didn't do that. They've got Ebola cases now. This is insanity, ladies and gentlemen. Only the U.S. and Spain are behaving like this. Central and South American and Caribbean countries have banned people from West Africa. General Kelly, the head of Southcom, admitted Africans are pouring in through the southern border, and that if Ebola ends up in Central or South America, there will be a huge exodus into the U.S. We've got to secure that border right now. But we don't have a lot of time. Once the panic starts, they won't be able to contain it. They've got to get in position now. This is default common sense. I've talked to top military brass, top virologists, epidemiologists, medical doctors on air. This is not my opinion. I've talked to Navy commanders, Coast Guard experts on disease. They say the default positions are being stopped. There is a stand down going on. To counter this, we are calling for a nationwide strike starting next Monday through Wednesday for you to stay home, especially if you're medical workers, police, EMTs that are going to be hardest hit by this, to draw attention to the fact that the federal government is on strike and not doing its default job, allowing these flights to come in. Even the Speaker of the House has said stop the flights. Senator Ted Cruz, Rand Paul, Governor Jindal of Louisiana, but not President Obama. He's out defending this. Now remember, it was someone flying in from Africa that brought it here, now spreading to nurses and clearly others. Why do they want it here? To create a bigger crisis, to get more funding, to be a political distraction from all the other scandals. And the new czar, who works for Al Gore previously, who has no Ebola background or experience, no medical training, he's an expert at divvying up tens of billions in funding to insiders to run the Ebola disaster, where literally hundreds of billions could be made, not just on the vaccine, but on the disaster itself. We're seeing a bank robbery here, ladies and gentlemen. We're seeing a crisis where the managers of the crisis are set to make billions and billions of dollars per week during this crisis that could go on for months, if not years, if it's not contained now. So go to Infowars.com or PrisonPlanet.com. Get the article with the hashtag Stop Ebola Strike. Send it out on Facebook, out on Twitter. Send our article with the videos of the general warning and others so that people understand we don't have to be powerless and just watch the federal government engage in criminal neglect by design. We can A, put pressure on them to take action, but B, if this pandemic gets out of control and becomes, you know, even worse, if this epidemic grows into a pandemic, then the people involved can be held accountable. But also it can be used as practice for sheltering in place and for self-quarantining if this gets out of hand. So Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, if you're not essential folks or people like myself that have got to be on air, self-quarantine is a test. We'll call it a national strike. Call talk radio, call Congress, call the White House, call media, send out tweets, be an activist Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday to fight Ebola and to stop Ebola with the Stop Ebola National Strike. We can stop it. There is a solution. There is a way to bring it down. There is a way to make them put the default actions in, and there may still be time to stop it before it spreads to thousands or even hundreds of thousands or more. And the whole Homeland Security apparatus has the pretext it needs for total federalization. Ladies and gentlemen, we've been warning of a biological false flag. This is clearly that. I don't know if they cooked it up in a lab, even though they have a history of doing that. I don't know that. I know that they've certainly let it in and are now doing everything they can to help it spread. So the ball is in your court. Send this to friends and family, your email list, Twitter, Facebook, other talk show hosts. Get them to cover it. Organize and be part of this strike, ladies and gentlemen. This is how we can draw attention to this and stop it. I'm Alex Jones, signing off for InfoWars Nightly News with this emergency news bulletin. I'm in Texas, just a few hundred miles away from Dallas and Austin. Undoubtedly, they're already thinking it's spread around the country. They've got people quarantined here in Austin as we talk about this on the news tonight. I have three children. I have a family. I am seriously upset by this, and I'm doing everything I can to draw as much attention to it as I can. Please join me in this. Let's not just be spectators and jellyfish and lay down. Let's prove Obama and these people that have such disdain for the American people wrong. And let's show them that we know who to blame. And let's show them that we demand that they not let this crisis grow, even though the White House did say, let's not let a good crisis go to waste. Well, to Rahm Emanuel and to Al Gore, that's part of the White House with his guy in there as the new Ebola czar, and to all of you, you will be held accountable. So do your damn jobs now. I'll be back this Sunday live, Lord willing, 4 to 6 p.m. Central with the Sunday show. We're now signing off for InfoWars.com and the whole crew. Please pray for us. We'll pray for you. Pray for America. Pray for West Africans as well. And pray that we be able to get the word out and get basic containment in place before it spirals out of control and we all end up getting quarantined, basically. And never forget, if you're watching this transmission, you are the hope, you are the resistance.
Highness Prince Charles, who can trace his ancestry back to Romania's dark and distant past.
The genealogy shows that I'm descended from Vlad the Impaler, you see. So I do have a bit of a stake in the country.
As it were.
He's giving people a life, forcing mothers to devour their own children. According to your own census, you killed over 100,000 people.
Forgeries and lies.
Do you deny that you murdered your own people?
Those who broke the law were punished.
What do you see as the biggest challenges in conservation?
The growing human population. Because if where we are, there's nothing else.
And do you have views about what should be done about that?
Can't you guess?
We've got to stabilize the population. When I was born, no, there were
so what's wrong with the population? I mean,
with too many people. That's why we have global warming. We have global warming because too many people are using too much stuff.
Back in 1997, when Ted Turner announced his historic support for the United Nations, no one could have known how the foundation would evolve and what its role would be. Today, we know that Ted Turner has delivered beyond anyone's best hopes. The UN Foundation has become the United Nations' best friend.
The negative impact of population growth on all of our planetary ecosystems is becoming appallingly evident.
New World Order, Mr. Rothschild?
Right.
New World Order? Depopulation?
Listen, who are you?
Genocide?
This equation has four factors, a little bit of multiplication. So you've got a thing on the left, CO2, that you want to get to zero, and that's going to be based on the number of people, the services each person's using on average, the energy on average for each service, and the CO2 being put out per unit of energy. So let's look at each one of these and see how we can get this down to zero. Probably one of these numbers is going to have to get pretty near to zero. Now that's back from high school algebra, but let's take a look.
The myth of overpopulation originated in England in 1798, when a vicar named Thomas Malthus, who fancied himself something of a mathematician, saw that food production increased incrementally, but people reproduced exponentially. He sat down and did some simple math and summarily decided that the world would be out of food by 1890. He blamed reduced mortality rates and recommended killing off the have-nots of society, lest the haves starve to death. This cry was taken up by Paul Ehrlich of Stanford University in 1968, who claimed that reckless human reproduction had overwhelmed the Earth. Massive famines would result, which would destroy, best-case scenario, one-fifth of humanity by the end of the 70s. And the planet would follow. This fear produced large donations for the newly created UNFPA, which thrives on an imagined crisis that has been both imminent and rescheduled again and again over the past two centuries. The truth of the matter is that every family on this planet could have a house, with a yard, and all live together on a landmass the size of Texas, which is really just a small corner of the planet. The population of Earth will peak in 30 years, and then start to go back down. We're not overpopulated. Do the math.
I began to get into iodine a few years ago because it was helping me and my family so much get healthy and detoxify. I believe our research is conclusive. This is the best iodine out there. And I know this for a fact. Nobody else has got iodine based on these pure crystals, ladies and gentlemen.
For a limited time, experience the ancient power of Survival Shield X2. Take advantage of this unprecedented 30% off super detox special at InfoWarsLife.com.
Introducing the first proprietary oxygen-based intestinal cleanser, OxyPowder, backed by FDA-approved phase 1, 2, and 3 clinical trials. All the toxins from the air, the food, the water, ultimately ends up in the gut or affects the gut. Take your health into your own hands and start cleansing your body today with OxyPowder. Secure your OxyPowder today at InfoWarsLife.com. That's InfoWarsLife.com.
This is Jakari Jackson here to address the political correctness in the United States of America. Because you see, you can talk about President Kennedy being a playboy. You can talk about Nixon being a crook. You can talk about Bush being dumb. You can talk about Bill Clinton's sexual appetites. But if you dare criticize President Barack Obama, well, you know what they call you. That's why we have this hashtag Ebola. Let's do this thing.
Well, this outbreak, we know that it's bigger because of it got into urban areas. We know that. You know, warming temperatures, stuff like that, you know.
Warming temperatures spread Ebola.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Well, it's not going to live in the Arctic, is it?
The hashtag Ebola contest. The $5,000 grand prize for displaying your poster in legal and lawful areas. Let's talk about the global warming.
You think it's a conspiracy, like, that somehow there's money to be reaped from...
Carbon taxes? Yes. And this probably isn't the most legal and lawful area. So with what you heard about Ebola, how do you think about the response from the CDC, the president, Governor Rick Perry?
I think the response is terrible. I mean, I think our borders should have been closed immediately when the outbreak happened. And I think letting these people travel after they've been exposed and not having proper quarantines is terrible.
Make sure you post a video on YouTube of yourself hanging the poster. Don't just take a picture of it.
I'm from Togo, West Africa. I don't believe Ebola.
You don't believe in Ebola?
No, I don't.
This is crazy.
Prove it to you right now.
Please prove to me that Ebola is not real. With something in your purse, you're going to prove to me it's not real?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, my boyfriend, U.S. Army?
Yes.
Where Ebola is?
But, I mean, is this proof that Ebola's not real?
I don't believe Ebola is.
So what's killing these people then?
We're killing Ebola. Jump can kill you.
Make sure you follow the full contest rules, which include but are not limited to placing hashtag Ebola on your poster, also InfoWars.com, and it doesn't hurt to have tyranny is the disease. Let's talk about what I discussed with the young lady here. I was asking her, well, she informed us that Ebola isn't real. You witnessed this as well?
Yes.
Okay.
I believe Ebola is real.
Be sure to go to InfoWars.com for full contest details, and remember to have your submission in by October 24th at midnight Central Standard Time. New Ebola shirts are available in the InfoWars shop.
You know, I know Alex Jones, that shirt is funny. I mean, the Ebola shirt, but yeah.
Thank you for watching the show tonight. If you are watching us on YouTube, go to the subscribe button and hit it. Become a subscriber to the Alex Jones channel and then head over to Prison Planet TV. Your subscription will give you instant access to over 18 years worth of material. And as always, you can share your username and password with up to 11 people at the same time. So that's 11 of you getting instant access to all the material you need to fight the info war. We'll see you here again Monday at 7 p.m. Central. City of Austin tap water versus filtered City of Austin tap water.
I can like taste dirt in it.
God knows what's in this.
This has an aftertaste. Tastes like Austin water.
Yeah, it does. Ugh.
These people just sampled City of Austin tap water straight from the faucet. Next, we had them try a sample of tap water filtered through the ProPure G2.0 filtration system.
High quality H2O.
That one is better.
Tastes like nothing.
Yep, I know what good water tastes like. It's good water.
Most tap water contains added substances like fluoride, chlorine, Monsanto's deadly pesticide, glyphosate, and many others. Studies prove that these substances are linked to an assortment of major health issues, including tooth decay, lowered IQ, and even cancer.
It tastes like you're drinking out of the lake when you're drinking tap water.
Yeah, it has that processed flavor to it.
The ProPure G2.0 filtration system removes these deadly substances and many more, leaving only fresh-tasting, deliciously clean water.
Okay, this is very tasty.
It's good water.
Refreshing.
It's good.
Go to InfoWarsStore.com today. Use promo code WATER and save 10% off your ProPure purchase. Again, that's InfoWarsStore.com or call 1-888-253-3139.
You are watching the InfoWars Nightly News, which airs 7 p.m. Central at InfoWarsNews.com. Members can share their passcodes with up to 11 other people, and your support is helping us defend liberty worldwide.